Hello all, this is Dr. Alsup, and in this video, we will be focusing on the basics of the vertebral column. So we're going to start with talking about the different parts of the vertebral column, specifically the vertebrae, and then we will get into the joints and ligaments of the column. And the vertebral column is called many different names. Sometimes you hear it referred to as the spine, which is sometimes used to refer to just the spinal cord, which I'm not so into. The spinal column you may hear, so numerous different names. We're going to try to stick to the vertebral column for our purposes. And it's more than just bone, because there's also going to be joints formed by the articulations of the bones of these vertebrae, as well as ligaments. And this column is going to surround the spinal cord and associated nervous tissue, as well as, importantly, the meninges. And there are five types of vertebrae that help make up the vertebral column. These first three are going to be movable vertebrae, and they're going to begin superiorly and continue inferiorly. And these last two types are going to be considered immovable or fused vertebrae, making up separate named bones. So we're going to start with the movable vertebrae beginning superiorly with the 7 cervical vertebrae. And we're going to get into how to distinguish vertebrae from one another in another learning objective video. But for now, let's understand that the cervical vertebrae are going to be superior. They are associated with the neck, and they are named C1 through C7. C1 would be the most superior and moving inferiorly. There are 12 thoracic vertebrae, and these will articulate with the ribs that we will see as we move through the year. And there are 5 very large lumbar vertebrae in the lower back region. And I like to remember the number of the different types of vertebrae by the times that I eat. So I eat breakfast at 7 a.m., I eat lunch at 12, and then I always catch that early bird special and eat dinner at 5 p.m. So that kind of helps me with remembering that. 5 sacral vertebrae will fuse or form bony joints to form the sacrum, and there is no movement between these vertebrae. And the sacrum does articulate with the hip or the coxal bones on either side, forming the sacroiliac or SI joints. And these SI joints are capable of some movement. And then most inferiorly, you will have 4 kind of remnants of vertebrae, and they will be fused coccygeal vertebrae. Typically, they're 4. They will start kind of larger and get very, very small by the 4th one. And colloquially, we refer to this as the tailbone. Okay, moving on to joints and starting with the superior most, the one that actually articulates with the skull or the head. So the joint between the occipital condyles and the superior articular facets of C1 or the atlas. Think of Atlas holding the world on his shoulders. That is where the name comes from. And this joint will permit nodding the head, yes. So think slight flexion and extension. Moving down one, there is a joint between C1 and C2, and actually it's really composed of 3 different joints. So you'll have 2 facet joints, which will kind of be on the opposite side of these superior articular facets of C1. So kind of on the bottom portion, because we're looking at a superior view here. And then a more midline pivot joint, which is going to be between the dens, as you can see here, this little projection of C2, projecting up to around the C1 level here. And this allows for a rotation or a pivoting motion. So if you think of shaking your head no, this is occurring here at this joint. But speaking of facet joints, there are a lot of them throughout the movable vertebral column between neighboring inferior and superior articular facets. And you can see one right here. There would be one right here too with the neighboring one and one right here. So pretty much the whole way down the vertebral column. And there'll be slight gliding movements that are allowed here. Lastly, and some may argue most importantly, are the intervertebral discs, which are located between neighboring bodies. So this is a body of the vertebrae, this is a body. It will be located between these neighboring bodies, between C2 and C3, down all the way to between L5 and S1. So you'll have one between each one of those bodies. And these are actually not synovial joints, but instead examples of symphyses, which are a type of cartilaginous joint. So it is the cartilage that's really connecting these articular bones. And it's composed of two layers, as you can see on this other side of the image, an outer annulus fibrosus, which serves the function of connection and protection of the inner nucleus pulposus, which is semi-fluid in composition and will be responsible for much of the flexibility of the IV discs and really that vertebral column as a whole. And the nucleus pulposus is actually a remnant of the notochord, which is the embryonic, mostly cartilaginous rod-like structure that will develop into the vertebral column. So this is a remnant of that. And it is this nucleus pulposus that may herniate through the annulus fibrosus, and we'll talk a little bit more about that in another video, but if you think we got spinal cord right there, we're going to have nerves exiting this region, so herniation can have implications. Lastly, let's finish our discussion of the vertebral column with some of the most important ligaments, as you can't talk joints without talking ligaments. Associated with the bodies of the vertebrae, there will be anterior and posterior longitudinal ligaments, and you can see the anterior longitudinal ligaments on the anterior side of the bodies, as its name would suggest, and the posterior longitudinal ligaments would be on the posterior side of the bodies. The ALL is going to be important in terms of limiting extension of the vertebral column, so no hyperextension or not allowing that. The PLL is going to be weaker and is clinically relevant as it helps to prevent or redirect posterior herniation of the nucleus pulposus. So if that fails as well, that has implications. Between the apices, or these most posterior portions, you will have what's referred to as the supraspinous ligaments. These are typically only present between C7 and L4, but are cord-like and robust and will merge with the ligamentum nuci, or the nuchal ligament, as you can see here, which extends from the external occipital protuberance and kind of bridges that gap between the relatively deeper and shorter spinous processes of the cervical region. The interspinous processes are going to be connecting the rest of the spinous processes, so kind of from that root of the region to the apices. The ligamentum flava will serve to connect adjacent laminae, or those flat portions of the vertebral arches, and you can see that really nicely right here. Flavus means yellow, and you can't see it in this image here because it's black and white, but the ligamentum flavum is, or flava is, very distinct yellow shade to this ligament as it is composed of yellow bands of elastic tissue and really helps to serve to resist separation of the laminae during movements of the vertebral column and helps to preserve that normal curvatures of the vertebral column. And you can also see a nice view, of the interspinous ligaments here between those spinous processes that have been cut. Okay, thank you for your attention here, and as always, we finish with the summary slide for this specific learning objective. Please do reach out with any questions you may have, and have a great rest of your day.